I just want to say a little bit about myself. I'm completely a novice in all that you discuss. Novice in the sense that as much of a novice as anyone else is who uses the digital medium without really fully understanding the nitty-gritty of the politics of it. And to that extent also belong to an organization and a set of people who want to understand the politics and therefore have continually viewed this medium as an opportunity but much more as a challenge, that if we don't properly understand this form of networking, how much will we be excluded more and more in this? And occasionally there's certainly an opportunity which has presented itself, but it's come not easily, and it's come with a great deal of difficulty. So even in what I say, forgive me for my to begin with, I may say some things that are just that seem completely foolish or stupid or may seem very simplistic, but part of that will be deliberate. The simplistic part of it will be deliberate. I have come from a meeting. I was one of the meetings I had gone outside India for was an interesting one. It was to look at the questions of research in the whole field of transparency, accountability and participation. And it was a second meeting. There was a meeting first of researchers, and they had produced many such charts, but in digital form. And they had now decided to get quote-unquote activists together to look at what were the strategic questions from the activist point of view that research should address. And from looking at the earlier meetings charts, there were two or three things. Again, I'll give a broad picture. A, I don't have time, and B, also I think that broad picture is useful. From our own experience, it was really strange that so many years down, when transparency, accountability and participation is sort of the theme of flavor of the times, there was a time when it wasn't, everyone thought, even amongst our own friends, that we were completely, I belong to a peasant and workers organization in Rajasthan, so for a peasant and workers organization to talk about right to information, transparency, accountability was thought of as outlandish by many of our own comrades, in a sense, colleagues who were doing similar kind of work, saying, why are you not talking about minimum wages and land, which is where we started all our questions from. But people understood so clearly the importance of information and fought for it in a very powerful, direct fashion. And to go to a meeting at a time when all this is so basic and important, and find people saying, but are there really outcomes from these? There were so many times when, and it seemed to me one of the things that struck me through the 2.5 days that that meeting took place is that there is research was so donor driven and so money driven that outcomes for donors, for foundations, for those who hold money mattered a hell of a lot. So those questions were coming from them, not directly necessarily, because this meeting actually dealt with quote-unquote activists. Again, I think India is privileged to have many activists that do not actually depend on donor funds. But around the world, there are very few, even in the field of transparency and accountability. And so those who were doing that kind of work were under this pressure that we have to perform within a year and we have to show outcomes within a year, and these things take time, which of course they take time, and researchers are put on our backs to say, what outcomes have you got in a year? Now, I belong to a movement that I think has been extremely powerful. We've been very privileged in India that right to information movement has penetrated all structures of power. It's fought, it fights day in and day out incredible power And it takes it on in a way that you could not believe, I could not believe in many ways, because people have understood the nerve centers of power, the nerve centers of information, what information they need, how they need it, how to use it best, how to use just information, leave alone the other things that need to come along with it. And they've understood it on their skin, in a sense. And that movement would never have developed if those questions that the researchers were asking 10 years down the line had been put to us year by year or 2 years at a time. So somewhere what seemed to happen, what I felt a lot, and which is why partly it was to me interesting to come to or to try and come to this meeting, to see whether there was a kind of a parallel or not. And in one sense, I think there's a danger of an even greater parallel, is that there is two things that happen. Number one, people who really do not deal with questions of power are dealing with questions of how power is organized. They are not facing it all the time, but they are feeling it second hand and third hand, and trying to understand it. And they understand the importance of it. They understand the importance, for instance, of the MKSS story. It's repeated ad nauseum all over the place. But they don't understand the nature of that struggle that took 10, 15 years to get to a point where it could really start for the rest of the world showing something that really was tangible, and that you could see that this was changing fundamental power relationships. All along the way, others saw it. Those who were engaged in that struggle saw it. But the net results came out when you had legislation, when you had 7 or 8 million users a year, when you have 40 people being killed under RTI. All those are things that are RTI users being killed. All those are very touchable, tangible. Today, you can just reel off 3, 4, 5 figures and everyone understands. Oh, yes, this has had a huge impact. But it had a huge impact from the very beginning, as people started asking the questions, looking at paper records, comparing it with the reality that was in their lives, comparing these information systems. So that's one. And the other just broad thing that I really fear, and this is something that has parallels in many ways. We started off as a peasant and workers organization in 1990, and there were a lot of issues in terms of how the language of change is brought about, is used. To me, actually, in one sense, let's say we certainly do believe in a kind of economic equality that people, I mean, as soon as we went, all the local people in our area called us communists. Local people meaning the people in the market, the people in government, other people. But in all our language, that was something that they thought in a broad sense that they ascribed to us. But one of the things that we were very clear about was whatever language of change would be determined by the people themselves. They would define that language of change. And it may have meant exactly the same things, but at least those terms and terminology was there. What I think even in the transparency and accountability movement is happening, and it's happening much more in things to do with the internet, is this technical language that is coming in more and more. That is frightening. I mean, to have a set of people, A, wanting to use something, and if we want to use it to try and change things. One document that came into me just as I came, I definitely need a glossary. I shudder to think of what others would need. INS, P2P, PN, RPN, NS, GS, GCS, ROW. I don't have a clue. Frankly.
Neither do we.
Yeah. And if this is going to be, I mean, that's going to, I understand that there is a great need for it because it cuts through many things and it makes things very quickly. Frankly, the first time, and why I've kept coming back, I really understood what ICT meant was when I came to a meeting of IT for Change. First, I tried to figure out what does ITFC mean. And And then, no, honestly, and this was many years ago. many years ago. And then ICT, while sitting in that meeting, that whole ICT came to me. And till today, I keep thinking every time ICT is used, everyone has forgotten information, communication, technology. Communication is certainly totally forgotten. IT is something that in this country is certainly well understood. But the whole package of putting it together and what that chemical means when you put these three together is forgotten when you use that term and the technical fashion in which it's put forth. So I just wanted to say that in terms of, I'll end now. I think it's, I mean, the internet, I don't have, again, that kind of time to go into. I think it's absolutely a necessity. We can't afford not to understand what it is. It is often definitely used as a means of control. Much of the digital world is being used more and more as a means of control with the poor, and therefore they have no choice but to understand how exactly that is happening. For those of us who are fighting that, I think we have to be able to understand that people who are complete lay people like me, like myself, will have to somehow be more comfortable with the terms and terminology and what we build up as an alternative ideology, because it's an ideology of a process. To my mind, there are two things. There is content and there is process in this whole thing. And that process is like how you, or at least what I understand of it, how you try and work out a democratic organization is how you try and work out a democratic process and platform. And in that, the language of that will also have to be something that the last and the most ordinary person understands. So what would I say research question should be is to come down to really just 3-4 basic issues that everyone here understands. Others also understand perhaps, but that can we make 3-4 terms of change really popular? Can we understand what are those terms that matter to people? Can we keep repeating them ad nauseum so that we don't have second and third generation terms that make us lose what we have as the essential and core principles? And can we have something that just says that these are the core basic principles of internet governance? Even civil society is such a badly used term. So global civil society even worse, and it is misused deliberately in many places, but that's another story.